In the following, we will look at the R-tree, a popular method to store multidimensional data, for instance, data points, segments, or rectangles. In this illustration, you see the university campus here in Kaiserslautern, the individual buildings, and now we can use the R-tree structure to index the buildings in our map. To do so, we can assume we can place a rectangle around these objects and then index them. We will see in a minute how this works. Now, if you plan, let's say, a party, and the party should happen in this space, and then this pink rectangle is our query rectangle Q, and then we can go and ask the R-tree to find all buildings that are indexed which intersect with this pink rectangle. The main idea in R-trees are minimum bounding rectangles. We will see what minimum means in a few minutes. Let's have a look at this illustration on the left side here, which illustrates an inner node of an R-tree. With all trees, we start at the root if you want to find or index an object. And these inner nodes are guideposts, pointers to which child nodes we have to go down the tree. If you consider like a binary search tree, and we have a number here, let's say 17, and then the decision to make at this inner node with 17 is to go left side down or right side down. The R tree, like the B plus tree, is like an emery tree, not a binary tree. So there are multiple entries, as we can see in this illustration here. And instead of having integer values or strings like in a B plus tree, which is a one-dimensional case, here, since we talk about multidimensional spatial data, so rectangles or segments and points, the inner node consists of entries, in this case four entries, which are described by rectangles. Minimum bounding rectangle means that each of these rectangles here, R1 or 2 or 3 and R4, they contain the objects which are stored in the subtrees in a minimal way. For instance, in R1, maybe we have this rectangle here and this object here. Let's say it's also a rectangle. And let's say this one here. If R1 contains these three objects, then R1 contains these three objects, then we indeed have R1 as a minimal bounding rectangle for these three objects, right? So it has to be minimal. Now, if we go now to see how we can search inside the R-tree, it is in principle very simple. So we have a query object, like a query rectangle, and we're looking at all of these entries, and we go down the tree in the direction that is described by the rectangles that intersect with our query rectangle, or query point in general. For instance, we have a query object like this, and then we look at R1, R2, R3, and R4, and we decide in this case clearly that we have to go down the tree following the pointer for rectangle R1. If we have a query like this, well, we have to take the pointer given by rectangle 2. And now it can happen that we have a query like this. And what's happening now, and this is surprising if you compare this to the way the B plus tree is queried, in this situation here, it can happen that we have to go down here because of this overlap. We have to go down here because of this overlap here. And we have to go down here because of this overlap, right? So it can happen if the indexing is done in an unfortunate way, or suboptimal way, and depending on the query, of course, we have to go down in all branches of an inner node further down the tree. And this has to be, of course, avoided because the performance is not anymore really, well, the tree structure is not really helpful anymore because we have to go down to many of these child nodes. So here's a bit larger example of an R-tree taken from the book by Hanan Samet. You see here on the left side the tree structure, And on the right-hand side, you see how the data space is partitioned using these rectangles. Or I should better say how it is organized using the rectangles. It's important to note that these rectangles don't have to be disjoint. As we can see here in the root, that has two entries described by rectangles R1 and R2, which are pink here in the right-hand side illustration. We see that these are overlapping. And if we have now a query, let's say querying for this rectangle here, so everything needs to be returned that is intersecting with this rectangle, you see that we have to go down in both branches starting from the root node. In the definition here, we see that every node of an R-tree has between small m and large m entries. The root has at least two entries, unless it is a leaf. The R-tree is similarly defined as the B-plus tree, or follows a similar idea. We also want to make use of the nodes adhering to the block size of our block storage devices, so there are multiple entries inside. And here we have rectangles in the R-tree that are pointing to child nodes, and in the B-plus tree we had one-dimensional, let's say, integer values for primary keys or strings as the separators. In the B-plus tree, these regions, so the data range the children would capture, do not overlap. In the R-tree now, this happens actually, or it can happen at least. Searching is similarly defined as for the B-plus tree. You have seen that already briefly in the illustrations before. But the difference is, also already mentioned that here it can happen that we have to visit multiple child nodes of one inner node. So it's not a clear separation like in the B-plus tree. The search works as follows. We have a query rectangle. Here it's called S. And T denotes the root of the tree. If T is not a leaf, that means it's an inner node with pointers to subtrees, then we look at all the entries E inside T. E, the entry, is described by a minimum bounding rectangle and a pointer to the subtree. If this rectangle in E overlaps with our query S, then we continue the search down the tree in the subtree to which E points. Otherwise, of course, not. If T is a leaf node, we look at all the entries and return all entries that overlap with S. And our search is done regarding this node T. So this algorithm here describes the case where we're standing at one node, T. Here we have rectangles inside that point to subtrees. And then if you apply this recursively, like in the case here, then the one level down, this would be the new T we apply in the algorithm, right? It's just like a recursive application of the search strategy. So how can we insert data to the R-tree? Let's have a look at this sample of a leaf node. So this leaf node stores three objects, R1, R2, and R3. And let's assume that this leaf is not full yet, so did not reach the capacity yet, and there's a new rectangle coming, and we want to insert this new rectangle inside this leaf node. You see what's happening? The new rectangle R4 is inserted, and in order to have this minimum bounding rectangle still capturing all the elements, so all the rectangles inside, it has to be enlarged. And now if you go on and insert another object, another rectangle, you see, now we have R5 also inserted, and the minimum bounding rectangle, which is this one here, is now capturing all of the rectangles. That's like a necessary requirement for the R-tree to work, because if we have an inner node somewhere in the tree And the entry here, let's say, is exactly pointing to this minimum bounding rectangle. And if we have a query object and we go the tree down and we arrive at this inner node, and then we intersecting the minimum bounding rectangle, like this one, and so on, with our query rectangle. And of course, if the query rectangle would be here, then we have to go down the tree because R5 is a hit, it's a query result. But let's assume we did not enlarge the rectangle, and the rectangle would still be the old rectangle, like this was like this. Then it's clear that we would not see at the level here that we have to go down the tree, because our query rectangle here, the red one, would not intersect with our pink minimum bounding rectangle. So it's obvious that we have to keep the bounding box, so this minimum bounding rectangle, always up to date when we're inserting data to the leaf node. And of course, if we're inserting data, as we just did, and this is our new minimum bounding rectangle, right? We have to not only update the description here, which is basically this blue rectangle, but we also have to propagate this change up in the tree in order to reflect that now the tree, or like this subtree, contains more information. And potentially, not necessarily, but potentially, this change will propagate up to the root node. In contrast to the B+ tree, it's not always clear in which subtree, or in which leaf in the end, we are inserting our object. Here you have the case of three minimum bounding rectangles, 1, 2, and 3, depicted here. And you see our rectangle R that we want to insert here. Now, the question is, where do we insert it? Because you can insert it in all of the three. I mean, not in all, but you can insert it into 1, or 2, or 3. This is like a funny observation. The object can be inserted anywhere. So you're not making any mistake. You can insert R into MBR2, or 1, or 3. If you're looking at this carefully, and you imagine that you're inserting R into MBR1, so the one here, what you have to do is then to enlarge MBR1 to capture the new object. Let's do this. This will look like this in the end, roughly, right? That means the space of MBR1 is immensely growing to capture this new object R. Well, not a problem, right? For the correctness, it doesn't really matter. It will work like this. You have to also, of course, then see what's happening if you're querying then now the tree. And you have a query object like this. Then this inner node here will say, oh, the inner node that stands for the, let's use the red color here. So this is pointing to a subtree here formed by the MBR1. And now this query object comes in. And then you say, okay, well, it overlaps, obviously, right? And then you go down the tree just to find out that there is no match in this MBR1 regarding this pink query rectangle. Why is this? Well, we have enlarged MBR1 to such an extent and created so much space, which is indexed by MBR1, but is empty. And this caused that we have to go down the tree, well, just to find in the end that there's no result. So you should, that's the important observation, avoid inserting objects to MBRs, to subtrees, which would grow very large in the end. The indexing of the object R is much better than using MBR2, because then the MBR2 increase is kind of small. Right? So it will be looking like this in the end, which is much better than the huge increase we had for MBR1. MBR3 is also a better choice than MBR1, but in this illustration here, for this example, the best way would be to insert it into MBR2. But again, the object can be inserted anywhere. And this is like a large contrast to DB plus tree. And here you see some formal definition of criterion for the overlap check between two rectangles R1 and R2. And if you want to implement this, this might be useful. As we discussed already, in principle, a new rectangle that needs to be inserted to the tree can be inserted in any node. If the node is full, we need to split the node like we did for the B+ tree in the undergraduate courses, if you recall that. And even if this tree is not, or the node is not full, perhaps we have to adapt the minimum bounding rectangle to propagate information up into the tree that now this subtree contains or describes a wider space. We have also discussed already for this insertion example that if you're extending bounding boxes, that this can lead to a poor performance of the R tree if not done wisely. The idea is to minimize overlap between minimum bounding rectangles, and you want to also minimize the spread, so the size of these minimum bounding rectangles. And by now it should be clear why minimum overlap and minimum spread is important to have a good performance. So here's the algorithm proposed by the author of the R-tree paper, Antonin Gutmann, papers from 82. And this is also one of these papers I would recommend to have a look on. You also see in the following slides that I have copied some pseudocode from this paper directly. This paper is a very good description, a very clear description. You should have a look if you want to really understand the tree in detail. It's very helpful. So here's the insertion algorithm that Gutmann proposed. This algorithm is called choose leaf. So you want to pick the leaf, to choose the leaf where we want to insert our object. We start, of course, with the root. And if the node we are looking at, this node n that we defined as the root, if this is a leaf, we are returning this node because we want to find the leaf. If n is not a leaf, that means we have an inner node of the tree. This inner node contains rectangles, and we have to find now the one rectangle we want to go down the tree and to insert our object inside this subtree described by the rectangle. So we're looking at all the entries of our node n. That would require the smallest area increase if we insert our object into that. If we have multiple options, so by chance it happens not only one rectangle has a certain minimum area increase, but multiple, then we take the one that has the smallest size, so the MBR, which is the smallest, for those that have the same minimum area increase. And this minimum bounding rectangle we pick now describes one subtree, and then we define n to be this child node described by this MBR that we just picked, and then we continue again with step 2. Right? Very simple, very intuitive how to do this, starting from the root going down. And now here the only thing which needs a bit sort is the definition where to go down. For the B+ tree, remember, it was clear where we have to go down, because there was no other choice. It was only one option, how we can interpret the entries in a B+ tree to search inside a tree. But here, since we have MBRs which are overlapping potentially, we have to come up with a heuristic in this case that tells us where we have to go downwards to the leaf nodes. So let's assume we applied the algorithm from before and we found a leaf node where we want to insert our new entry. Now we discuss what happens if this leaf is full. And if the leaf is full, just for the case, or in the case of the B-bus tree, we have to now split the leaf into two leaves. And we have to decide now how we are doing this split. For the B-bus tree, it was simple because we would just take the middle element as the split indicator. And here, for the R-tree, similarly to the case of where can we insert, the answer for the split is, well, the split can be done arbitrarily. We call this the split problem. Consider having m plus 1 entries, so we just exceeded the maximum capacity of our node. And now the question is, which two subsets of these entries should be considered new and old nodes? I want to split the old node into two groups, the ones that are remaining in the old node and the ones that are put into the new node. For the B plus tree case, as I said already, this is clear. Here it's totally not clear. Any subsets would do. Because of the property of the minimum bonding rectangles as the guidepost within these inner nodes. Any subset would do. For instance, we have the following four rectangles that need to be assigned to two nodes. And we want to do this in a meaningful way. How could this look like? Well, if you're taking, let's say, the red one and the blue one together, we're creating this minimum bonding rectangle. And you see there's a lot of space here that does not contain any object. That's probably not a good way to do that. So we call this like a good split or a poor split. In this example, I have illustrated a poor split. A good split, as you probably imagined already, would happen if you're taking these two together in one node and these two together in the other node. Why is this a good split? Well, the resulting nodes, if you're taking a minimum bonding rectangle to describe the elements in this node, these MBRs are quite compact. Of course, there's still like some white space. For instance, for this minimum bonding rectangle, there's this area which is like indexed, but there's no object. But of course, it's much better than having the white space here, which would cause, if a query comes in looking like this, and then the right-hand side partitioning would identify this MBR as a potential hit, or as a hit that has potential results. In this case here, we would not even go into any of these because we see already that these two are not affected by our query object. So let's see how we can address the split problem. The split problem again means that we have m plus 1 entries because we have m as the maximum capacity of our node, plus 1 because, well, we have just inserted one element that made this node overflow. And the problem here is, how do we distribute these m plus 1 entries to two nodes? Gutman, in the original RT paper, writes that there are 2 to the m minus 1 possibilities to do this assignment, with m being 50 as a reasonable, realistic assumption. That means it's clear that due to this exponential growth for large parameter m, there's no way we can investigate all possible subsets and then just pick the best one. This is too expensive, it's not practical. To solve this problem, a quadratic cost algorithm was proposed for the problem of splitting m plus 1 nodes into two sets. And here's how it works. This algorithm is of course not correct. It will not give you the optimal one, but it is hoped that it will give you in practice good results, because the optimal solution, at least in the naive way, would be impractical. Let's see how this algorithm works. You start by looking at pairs of objects that would cause the largest area, the largest MBR area, if we place them in the same node. So basically that means we look at these entries, these objects, that are not a good fit to put together in one node, because the MBR would be really big. And then, of course, we don't put them into the same node, but we put them into different nodes. So now we have two nodes. And this is our problem, right? We want to assign these n plus one entries to these two nodes. So we have defined these two nodes by initial entries we put there. Just as I said, look at the entries which would be the worst fit to be put together in a node, and then we put them to two different nodes, right? So now we have these two nodes, and then you're looking at all the remaining entries and consider the one for which the increase in area has the largest possible difference between the two nodes. So this is our one node we have as a choice, and this one. So if you're looking at the rectangle now, an object that needs to be assigned to the left or the right choice, and let's say we have this one here, that would mean that here we have an increase like this of the MBR, but here we have this huge increase if you put it to the right hand side. And this, in case the difference between the increases is not higher for other objects, we would take that object now here, well, the red one it was before, right? And we would assign this one to, of course, the node here on the left-hand side. And we repeat this until we have all entries assigned to the left or the right side. And here's the algorithm defined, or like a pseudocode definition of this quadratic cost algorithm from the original paper, if you want to read it here. But again, I would suggest that you look up the paper, because R-trees are quite essential also for forthcoming algorithms for nearest neighbor search. So it's a good idea to understand really what's going on. So what happened before was we have one node which was full, and we split it into two. This is the old one, and here we have a new one, and here was the inner node that pointed to the old one. So now, by the split algorithm, it's very likely, or almost certain, that the MBR of the old one has changed. So we have to go here to the parent and adjust the MBR, and for the new one here, we have to insert the new one into the upper level inner node, and also insert here the MBR of this node new. And then it can happen, because of these changes made by the insertion of the object and the split, it can happen, or will happen in many cases, that the MBR of this node here is also changing, right? And of course, like the tree to be correct, these MBRs of all the inner nodes have to precisely describe the space of the subtrees and the objects which are contained there. That means we have to change this one as well, the MBR description. Well, one level up, right? We have to do this. So we are updating the MBR here. And again, it can happen now that this one also needs to be changed here on this one, because the MBR changes, and then we have to propagate this change up. And this is exactly what the method adjusttree is doing. It will propagate changes bottom up, and of course handling also splits in a recursive way, because if we are inserting this new object here to the parent node, it gets a new MBR, and if this one then is overflowing, we have to again apply split and propagate the changes up. And this is done by the adjusttree method. An important observation is that the R-tree is a balanced tree. That means if you're going down from the root to the leaves, it has always the same number of levels to visit. So this paper by Gutmann is one of these seminal papers, so very important papers in database research, or also for practical purposes, of course, not only research. And there's been a multitude, not only of applications, but also follow-up work. And probably the most popular improvement is the so-called R-star tree. You see the reference here. And here the idea is to improve the splitting algorithm to be creating or to be causing better trees in terms of the performance in the end. So you're not looking at the area increase, but the splitting algorithm proposed here also looks at the degree of overlap, which is like an additional improvement over the initial R tree.